Hi, this is Mark Hopkins. Welcome back to another episode of Unsung. This week, I'm interviewing an old friend of mine who years ago made the choice to go into the medical profession, and we're going to discuss what she's seen and how she came to make that choice over time. And I'm just going to refer to her by her first name, Joanna. Thank you for being on the show.
Hi, Mark. Good to be here.
She's very talkative, great conversationalist, listens to the show fast, very nervous. She's, as we've gotten closer to the interview, she's clenched up more and more. And that's, and that's why she's talking like she's selling aluminum siding. How long have you been in nursing?
I graduated from nursing school in 2005 and went right to work that year, so 13 years.
And what was the incubus that made you decide to go into nursing? Because you were doing, I mean, it was looking like you were going to, I mean, I always thought you'd be a photographer or something, you know, the way things were going, or something to do in the...
Yeah, well, me too, and I was, but I found that I didn't really enjoy photography as a profession, and I was kind of looking for something else, but not real actively, and then my father got sick, and I ended up helping to take care of him, and in that process, I think that this is a lot of people have the same story. In that process, I realized that I kind of enjoyed that role and being in that world. So that kind of led me towards nursing.
And it's amazing how some people would say, myself included, that you can in some ways be distant and cold, but when it comes to dealing with people, you dive right in. You know.
It depends. I think it depends. Yeah, a lot of people would say that I'm maybe guarded. I like to say guarded more than cold, really. But I think it depends on who I'm dealing with and how well I know them. But when it comes to nursing, I think that it's different because you immediately feel a responsibility to whoever you're taking care of, and that definitely changes your demeanor. Right away, well, you want them to feel at ease and you want to make them feel well cared for. And as a professional, you just kind of, I think, naturally fall into the role of, well, not being guarded for starters.
Well, just to be clear here, in this instant, guarded is too cold as Big Bones is too fast. Because she's using kind, polished words that she's practiced over the years.
I don't know. If, I don't think cold is nice. guarded is accurate.
The when you got started nursing, do you remember like a first lesson that made it real to you? That made it stand out? That it was your career now?
You mean the first time I realized I had made the right choice, or that it was a good fit for me, that kind of thing?
That it was, or that you really, it went from being a study to a profession, and you knew you were all in at this point.
That probably happened in increments over a period of time, but I do remember my first job. I was working, I wasn't in the job for very long because I was going to be moving out of state. So I got a job right out of school. And it was just basically handing out medications and being a go-to person for any health-related concerns at an independent living facility. So, you know, there was always a nurse on call, and so at night, that was me. And when people would call up the nurse's office and say they hurt themselves or they fell over or they weren't sure if they needed to go to the hospital. It was me and only me who showed up to figure it out. So that was kind of a feat to the fire. I thought it was going to be a cushy job, but that was kind of a feat to the fire way of finding out real quick that that I could sort of manage these kinds of assessments, decisions, be able to talk to people about their intimate health concerns, which, you know, at first that was a little touchy for me, but that happened, you know, you real quick fall into the groove when you're in that position. I think I just rambled. Take over, Mark.
Oh, no. No, that's fine. It's just, that's one of those things. I think maybe that's part of what made it appealing to you is that you kind of, we're similar in that way. I think we deal better with things when they're not going right or more comfortable with that because of the way life has been that, there's a certain comfort in chaos.
That's probably true.
Because, you know, I mean, I think we're both the kind of same way. If everybody's sitting around with nice linen napkins and four forks and china and classical music is playing, that we're waiting for disaster. You know? This normalcy can't continue. What's going on here?
This can't be right.
Right. It's a strain to maintain normalcy and just relax during it. I'll speak for myself. But I can't actively dive in and participate in normalcy to keep it going, but I can help put it in the chaos. I guess that's the best way to put it.
Yeah, and that probably pretty much sums up the medical field.
Yeah, and I think that the people that do it are, you know, people throw around phrases like adrenaline junkies and stuff like that, and that's just the wrong phrase. I'll jump on that the way you jumped on cold, you know.
Well, what's the phrase? Wait a minute, what's the phrase?
Adrenaline junkies, you know. I see that they use that phrase a lot of times for people in emergency services, medicine, in general.
Yeah.
And I think there is a part of the population that is of that mindset, but it's nowhere near representative of the entire population. What's the best part of your job?
The best part of my job?
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, you know, it's pretty cliche to say the people, but, you know, it is the people. And when you know that you're making someone's, even if you're making someone's day better or hour better, that really is the best part. And it's not, you know, the profession is full of paperwork and time crunches and pressures from the outside that limit your ability, or it seems like it limits your ability to work with patients directly sometimes. But when you do get that one-on-one meaningful interaction, that's the best part.
What's the hardest part?
The paperwork, the bureaucracy, the time crunch, never enough time. That's the hardest part.
And it's like a lot of things where a lot of professions, where more of the job has become over time because of insurance, liability, different things, the support of the job than actually doing the job.
It's a lot more about business than you would like it to be, but it's business, and you have to function. I think this is worse for doctors, really, but you have to function in the business while still making people feel cared for. That can be challenging sometimes.
But it's tough when they stack you with work, and they have, you know, just irrational schedules. If you're in a rush, you're in a rush, and sometimes people get caught on the bad side of that, and they get the wrong snapshot of you in the midst of doing something chaotic, or just, you know, you're just rushed, and they think that's who you are, and that's just the day you're having.
Yeah, and I think that it's across the medical professions, from physical therapists, nurses aides, doctors, everybody I think feels that time crunch, and it interferes with how you would really like to take care of people. But I think that recently in the last year, I started working in the OR, and the OR environment is very much, it's very time-driven, schedule-driven. Like, it's, you know, when you're working on a floor, and that's also time-driven. But, you know, you're a little more flexible in your schedule with the patient, a little bit. But when it comes to working in the OR, the surgery is scheduled to start at a certain time, and you have to be done by a certain time. The room has to be turned over or ready for the next patient at a certain time. You know, so that, as it's a different way of dealing with the time crunch.
But in a way, it's better, because the OR doesn't pretend to be anything else. You know, it doesn't pretend.
Well, it's better and worse at the same time. I mean, it's worse because you go to see your patient before the surgery, and you have not very much time to talk to them, assess them, make them feel at ease, or whatever it is you're trying to accomplish in that interaction. You have not a lot of time. You have a few minutes, literally. Whereas if you're spending a day with a group of patients, as you are on the floor, you have a little more time to interact with them, get to know them, learn their history, all that stuff.
Yeah, I think
you're running all day. You're running all day, for sure.
Yeah, it's got to be emotionally draining, but in some ways I think the OR, a lot of people that come in with known issues, and they pretty much just, they don't want to chat, just fix me. Hurry up. You know, they're in a rush too at that point.
Yeah, that's true. Their expectation is not that you're going to hang out and have conversations with them. So that's true too, but, you know. I think that we all feel like we're like I said, everybody across the all different levels of the medical profession feel that time crunch.
Yeah, and it's not good to be rushed. But in the time you've been doing it, and you've been doing it for how long did you say?
13 years.
Okay, so. Time for your career bar mitzvah or bas mitzvah. How has technology changed?
How has technology changed? Well, I've worked in different areas of the profession. So in the OR, technology changes frequently. I mean, the basics are always there, but, you know, there's constant updates in the technology, but I find that stimulating. You know, I like working with new technology and learning new machines and all that kind of stuff.
Isn't it possible in medicine, like some other professions, to move between jobs and actually go backwards in technology?
I'm sure that's true, but I think that in the medical profession, unless you're moving from a hospital environment to like a community health environment, I think you're always gonna be dealing with updates in technology. But if you were going from a